Pastor Keith. Thank you, worship team. Good morning. Happy Easter. I hope and pray that you and your family are doing well this morning. We miss you. We love you. And we are certainly praying for you this morning. Hey, I'm so excited to be bringing the message and hear these wonderful gospel songs about who he is and what he has done and the power of the resurrection that still today is changing lives. Many people say, what's the evidence of the resurrection? Well, I'm going to tell you one of the greatest evidences simply is people's lives are being changed. Hey, this morning, before we pray, let me just share a couple of needs with you. Carol Morgan is having some difficulties. So, Miss Carol, if you're listening, God bless you, and we're praying for you. Sue Martin continues to need our prayers. We're lifting you up. Max and Whitney Barnett. These are all families who are going through some difficult times right now. And so I pray in Jesus' name that God would bless these families. And I know there are others. And right now, maybe you just need to raise your hand and say, Father, I'm one today that is in need of help and hope in my life. And so we pray for these. Hey, in just a moment, I'm going to ask you before we get ready to sing the next song to get ready to give. Thank you so much for your faithfulness to give almost every day. When I go to the mailbox or out behind the church, there's checks. And so thank you for your faithfulness to give. So let me encourage you, get out your checkbook, get out your computer, get out your phone. Ever how you give, one of five ways, and you see those, however you choose to do that, thank you for your faithfulness, committing to worshiping the Lord through your tithes and also through your just your faithfulness to give. So as you get ready to do that, go ahead and ever how you choose to do it, let's get ready to do that, okay? Hey, as you do that, this morning I'm going to ask you to do something different, okay? A few weeks ago, our president asked for a National Day of Prayer and failed to recognize that. So today we're going to do that, and I'm going to ask you to do something with me if you're physically able. I was watching the news last week when a certain country, people were walking out into their driveways and literally getting on their knees and lifting their hands and asking God to heal their land. So I'm going to ask you if you're physically able as we get ready to give and worship him in that. If you can, if you're in your chair, on your couch, in your bed, if you're physically able, join me as we kneel and ask God to bless this country. Let's pray for our political leaders who are having to make hard, hard decisions about their towns or the state or the country, whoever they may be. Many people are involved in these decisions. So let's please pray for them that God would give them wisdom and discernment. Let's pray for the medical people who are on the front line helping us bring safety and cures into our life. And so as we bow in just a moment, let's ask God to help them. And then let's pray for our country that in this dark time we would see the light of the hope of the good news of the gospel. Okay? So, hey, if you're physically able, I'm going to ask you just to bow on your knee. And today we're just going to commit this time to the Lord and ask him to bless and to heal our land. If you physically can, if you can't, we understand. Father, we bow our knee today in surrender and submission to the authority and the lordship of Jesus Christ. Father, we pray for the president, for the Congress, for senators, House of Representatives. We pray for governors. We pray for state legislators as they have to make hard decisions about their towns, their states, and this country. And so, God, I thank you for their service. But, Lord, I pray that they'd have a heart for you and that, God, your spirit would speak discernment, God, into their lives so they know what to do. And then, Father, I want to pray for those medical people, those frontliners, those first responders who are there to immediately give help and aid to people who are sick. And, God, I know they're tired and they're weary and they're working long hours with limited resources. So, God, I pray for them today that, Lord, in Jesus' name, that, God, you'd bless them. And then, Father, I want to pray for our country that somehow, some way, that, God, you would use this as a call to renewal, a call to repentance. In the old days, we called it revival. And so, God, I pray that, Lord, you'd bring us back to a place of holiness, a standard of righteousness, Father, where we lean upon you and we look to you, and, Lord, we love you. And so, Father, on this resurrection morning, as we celebrate the good news, the great news, I like what one person said, the church may be empty, but so is the tomb. And because the tomb is empty, and because he lives, the old song said it best, we can face tomorrow. So, Lord, receive our praise and worship as we give, but also we pray for our country. Bring us back to the heart of worship. Lord, we love you and we thank you. For all those out there who are discouraged, who may be hopeless, who may be discouraged, I pray in Jesus' name that God, during this time, you'd just speak a word of newness, revival. Speak a word of hope in their life. Lord, we love you and we praise you. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. And all the church said, amen. Amen. Hey, we serve a risen Savior. Let's sing and worship today. Pastor?
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy. I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always here. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see His loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that He is leading through all the stormy blasts. The day of His appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. Hallelujah to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all. come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested and my life began. That's when death was arrested and my life began.
Oh, death was arrested. Then our life began.
Holy, holy is He.
honor you this morning. We celebrate you, Lord, for you are not dead, you are alive. Your tomb is empty, and you are seated at the right hand of the Father, interceding on our behalf, and we worship you today, Lord. Father, I know that this has been a interesting Easter. Very interesting Easter. Churches all over the world, empty. At least the buildings. At least the buildings. Because we're the church. Just like that tomb's empty, you're living right inside of us. And yeah, the buildings are empty today, Lord. But our hearts are full. And we are worshiping you in spirit and in truth today. Father, bless the words of Pastor Ronnie today, Lord. I lift him up and ask that you bless everything he says. May it not come back void. I know there's got to be somebody watching somewhere this morning, Lord, that needs help. They need hope. And this morning, we offer that to them. Jesus is alive. Whatever's going on in your life today, he can take care of. Today, Lord, we ask that you bless us and give us peace and comfort, joy immeasurable, running over. Father, we love you today. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Well, amen. Thank you, Pastor Keith, and praise team and musicians. Thank you for helping us as we celebrate the great news that he is alive. Hey, somebody challenged me about a week ago and said, hey, Pastor, with everything going on, how in the world can we have hope? And I simply responded, because he lives. And because he lives, you and I can face tomorrow. We can face the difficulties that come in different ways, and we'll talk about a few of those in just a moment. So, hey, before I get into that, let me remind you, please listen to all the folks who are trying to help us with the medical tips and safety. Please listen to those as you go out if you have to. Also, let me say this, with all of the weather today, please be safe and wherever you're at, snuggle in and make sure that you're watching the weather and that you're safe. Hey, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to the Gospel according to John, the 11th chapter. This morning, we're going to do something a little different. We're going to preach about the resurrection, that is for sure. But I want to do it from a different story about a resurrection. And we know that guy's name by the name of Lazarus. In the Gospel according to John, the 11th chapter, we have the great story where Lazarus is sick. And by the way, if you study Lazarus, he was a friend of the Lord Jesus. He was the brother of Mary and Martha. And the Bible says that oftentimes when Jesus traveled through that part of the country, he stayed at their home. And so he was not a stranger. As a matter of fact, many theologians said that it was home away from home. It was not unusual to find Jesus at the home of Lazarus, Mary, and Martha. And so we find ourselves in chapter 11 in a kind of a, and I want to call it just a difficult moment. Lazarus is very sick. They have sent word to him, Lazarus' friend Jesus, that the one whom you love is sick, and they thought he would probably come. He would drop everything, and he would come quickly, and if he didn't, then they knew that he had the power to heal him wherever he was. Matter of fact, they had witnessed many miracles. They had seen Jesus do astounding things, and yet in this moment, when the one who he loved, the one that he called a personal friend, was sick, they thought surely that he would come, and soon their brother Lazarus, Jesus' friend, would be taken care of. Well, he will be, but it's just not the way that they wanted. Have you ever noticed that so many times God does what needs to be done in our life, but he doesn't do it the way we want him to do it? He does it his way. By the way, could I just say this? His way is always the best way. So as we celebrate this morning, as we're thankful to God, I was just writing some songs down in my office. Some great resurrection songs. How many of you remember this old good one? Ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. That's the resurrection. Here's a great one. Arise, my love. Y'all remember that great Easter song we used to sing? Arise. Dallas Home in the early 80s, I think, wrote Rise Again. Man, what a song. It revolutionized Christian churches and the way we worship God. And then I think about that old steady song, simply says, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Well, here's the story. I'm not going to read verses 1 through 16. I hope you will do that. I'm going to describe what's going on. I'm going to begin in verse 17. Before I do that again, let me just set the stage. Lazarus is sick. They sent word for him to come quickly, Mary and Martha. Where's your friend? Where's that one that you love so much? And Jesus said, we're going to go, but we're just not going to go right now. And again, you can read that. We're just going to look at when he showed up, what happened, and then some things to think about, okay? So let's read the Word of God together. Verse 17 of the Gospel of John, the 17th chapter. So when Jesus came, and literally some say when he finally got there, wow, Jesus is never early, and I promise you he's never late. So the Bible says when he finally came, he found that he had already been in the tomb 4 days. Earthly speaking or humanly speaking, it's a hopeless situation. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles away. They had a problem. Jesus had been run out of there. Jesus had been almost killed there, and his disciples couldn't believe that he was going back so near to the place where they threatened his life. Matter of fact, they challenged him, Lord, we can't go there. You know what they're going to do if we show up. And so the Bible said he was willing to risk his life to get there. And many of the Jews had joined the women around Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha said to Jesus, now listen to these words. Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. It's faith, but it's not the kind of faith that ultimately brings about victory. But he said this, but even though now I know that whatever you ask God, God will give you. And then Jesus makes an astounding statement. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. And Martha said, yeah, I know. In the last resurrection, he will rise. Jesus said to her, and these are the verses that I want to look at today. I am the resurrection and the life. And he who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And then he makes a bold statement. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Man, what did he mean by that? And then he gets very personal. Do you believe this? Wow, do you believe the resurrection? Do you believe that Christ can change your life? That he can make things happen that you never dreamed could? And she said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, who was to come into the world. Hey, let me make some opening remarks. Number one, it was a very difficult time. Sickness and sorrow had come to the house of Mary and Martha, and their brother lay sick. Like most of us, we would want to do everything we could to ensure his health, his healing. And so they did the only thing they knew to do. They sent word to the Master, the Lord Jesus, the one who they had seen heal before. And so they're in a difficult time. Could I just kind of resonate this? Man, a lot of people are saying we're living in very difficult times. Pastor Keith said it well. This is the most unusual Easter in my over 40 years that I have ever experienced. Now, I've had some Easters where it was cold, where it was snowing, where it was rainy like it is today. But I'll tell you, friend, I've never preached an Easter in an empty building. Different times, isn't it? Man, they were at the part of being heartbroken. Where is the Lord Jesus? Why didn't he come? Some even said that they're disappointed. Here's a guy that said he loved Jesus. I thought he was our friend. I thought he loved us. I thought surely if anybody would come to our aid, it would be him. Have you ever asked God to do something and it seemed like he delayed in coming? Sure. Have you ever been in a place where you said, God, I thought you said, and yet it didn't seem to go the way you thought it ought to go? And so not only was it a difficult time of sickness and sorrow, hard times, but it was a time of disappointment. It seems like we live in a world today of extreme disappointment. People critical and caustic about everything, including the Bible, the church, and even the Lord Jesus. Jesus, where are you at? We ask you to come. We're waiting on you. Matter of fact, I believe that Mary and Martha probably went to the door every day. They went to the window every day, went to the porch, looking down the lane or the road, expecting to see a figure coming. And yet day after day, he never came. Could I just say this? They were very depressed. Listen to the words of, I think, Martha. Lord, if you had only been here. Wow. God, if you'd only been here, things would have been different. Lord, if you'd have showed up like we needed you to, then something could have happened in a miraculous nature. So let's set the scene between verse 1 and verse 16. It's difficult. Matter of fact, I kind of alluded to it. It was a very dangerous time because Jesus came very close to Bethany where they tried to kill him. Very disappointed because they thought surely if anybody would come, it would be Jesus. And depressed. Lord, if only you had been here. But then Jesus said, Martha, your brother will rise again. And then he made that bold statement, that extreme statement that I want to base this whole thought of today. It simply said this, verse 25, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, even though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives, believes in me, shall never die. Do you believe this? Boy, what some amazing words. Hey, I got four thoughts for you with the time we have today. Number one, notice an absolutely unbelievable claim. Nobody had ever claimed this before. Matter of fact, I just went back in my mind and pulled up some things where people made claims and some made good on it, some didn't. How many of you remember Houdini who said that after he died, that he would come back a year later and his wife was to light a candle or turn on a light and that he would make contact with her from beyond the grave. And they said that for 10 years she did that, but on the 10th year, she realized he wasn't coming back. Even though he claimed he was, he didn't. Here's a good one, Douglas MacArthur, World War II. He claimed to the Allied forces, he claimed to the Filipino people that I will return. I'll be back. And he made good on that claim. Here's one that most of us probably remember, Muhammad Ali. He used to pick the round that he would knock people out. That's pretty bodacious. But he did that. And then I remembered this one, Pastor Keith, Joe Namath. Brash, young Alabama graduate said in 1969, part of the New York Jets, AFL, we will win the Super Bowl against the great Baltimore Colts. Man, what a prediction. What a claim. And that was big news. If you don't believe it, go back and look at the interviews. I did. Man, they thought he was a smart aleck. They thought he didn't know what he was talking about. Matter of fact, the odds were 9-1 that they would lose. And yet, Joe Namath, with that finger in the air, you remember, number one, Jesus said, now listen, as great as these men are, some of them are renowned, some of them had great power, some of them had great prestige and possessions, but all of their claims, now I want you to listen carefully, none of them come close to the claim that Jesus made. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me shall never die. Man, what a claim. Never heard anything like that before. They had seen some big miracles, but Jesus is declaring that he has authority over the grave. Look at it. Revelation chapter 1, if you have your Bible or if you just mark it down. Listen to what Jesus said about his authority, and that's the idea that I want to get. This claim is unbelievable. It's because of his authority. Listen to this. I am he who lives. This is after the resurrection and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. And the church said, amen. But listen to what he said. And because of the resurrection, because of the authority I have the keys of death, hell, and the grave. Man, if you understand anything about keys, it means you have ownership. You have accessibility. And so the Bible says his authority. Let me make three quick statements. He destroyed the works of darkness. S.M. Lockridge, in his great, great message, maybe one of the greatest I've ever heard, That's My Key, said death couldn't hold him and grave couldn't handle him. You can't impeach him and he's not going to resign. Amen. You know why? Because I am, he was, he is the resurrection. His authority. Not only did he destroy the works of darkness, I'm going to tell you this, and you listen careful, church, he defeated the plan of the devil. John 10:10 says, a thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. We looked at that last week. Not only did he destroy the works of darkness, but he defeated ultimately the plan that the devil had for your life, and that was to destroy you. The only way that it happened was because of the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ. I am the resurrection. He declared deliverance, but I've come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. So in this first idea that he made an unbelievable claim, we see his authority, but listen carefully, and I want you to hear my heart. I'm not being irreverent here. You know, it's something to say something, one thing, but it's another thing to do it. So I want you to see this. It's one thing to say you're going to do it. It's another thing to do it. Not only do we see his authority, but we see his ability. Not only did he say he was going to do it, thank God to the glory of the Lord, he did do it. Amen? I was he who was dead, but now I am alive. It's one thing to say it. It's another thing to do it. I was just kind of looking through some of the chapters in the Bible about Easter. Now, the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been rolled away from the tomb. So she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciples whom Jesus loved and said to them, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've laid him." Peter therefore went out and the other disciple John, and they went to the tomb, and they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter and stooping down looked in, and he saw the linen clothes lying there. Now watch carefully, but it didn't go in. So Simon Peter followed him and went into the tomb, and he saw the linen clothes. You know the story. They went back. They were kind of dumbfounded. But the women stayed, supposing him to be a gardener. Jesus said, "Mary, it's me." Not only his authority over death, hell, and the grave, but the ability to do what he said he could do. If Jesus said he could change your life, he can change your life. Because he lives, we can face tomorrow. So today, I just want to encourage you in Jesus' name. Remember this, the unbelievable claim, the unimaginable claim. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection life, and because of me," the Bible said he destroyed the works of darkness. He defeated Satan's ultimate plan, and he delivered you and I unto death. Hey, here's a third one, and Miss Lisa, I didn't have time to give you this one. It added later. It's okay. Romans 5, 1 and 2, accessibility. Not only authority and ability, but now because of the resurrection. Listen to these phenomenal words. "Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into the grace in which we stand and rejoice forevermore." I don't know about you, but I'm glad he's the resurrection. And then Jesus said, "I'm not only the resurrection, but I'm also the life." How do we know that? Because of his authority. We know that because of the ability to do what he said he could do and will do and wants to do. And by the way, let me emphasize this. He wants to change your life. He wants to allow you to enjoy the peace and the power that comes. But I'm going to tell you, he gives you access to God. I'm so glad that we don't have to go through another man to get to him. And I'm not throwing stones right now. I'm just saying this. There's only one priest, and his name is Jesus. And the way to the Father in the book of Hebrews says he tore down the middle wall, the partition, and he made it available and accessible that you and I could go straight into the throne room of God. So today I'm excited about the resurrection because of an unbelievable claim. Number two, I want you to notice this. Because of this unbelievable claim, he is, and I want to say this with everything that's in me, he is the unconquerable Christ. He is the unconquerable Christ. Jesus preached the resurrection. If you don't believe that, go back and read John 12, 13, and 14. Jesus even told them, "Hey, I got to go to Jerusalem. I'm going to suffer. I'm going to die at the hands of sinners." You remember what Peter said? "No, sir. Not going to allow it to happen." Jesus preached that he would, without a doubt, ultimately go to a cross, die for the sins of the world. He promised it. God planned it, but Jesus preached it. Jesus promised it. And I love this. Then Jesus produced it. So you and I today live on this side of the Calvary and of the resurrection. By the way, let me just clearly make this known to you. Without the resurrection, we really don't have anything to say. A lot of people died on the cross. I'm not diminishing what he did on the cross in any way. He was a perfect, sinless Lamb of God. But the resurrection validated the crucifixion. And without the resurrection, we have a good work, we have great Lord, we have a great teacher, but we don't have life. And Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life." The only way that could happen is the fact that he is Lord of all. And so the Bible said not only did he make an unbelievable claim, but he is absolutely the unconquerable Christ. Satan threw everything he could at the Lamb of God. We've read about the temptations and now the crucifixion, and yet on the third day, thank God, he arose. You and I, 2,000 years later, are still living on the biblical truth, the evidence that Jesus lives. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living no matter what men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear the voice of cheer. And I love this phrase, Pastor. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives. He lives. You ask me how I know he lives? He lives within my heart. Wow. So Jesus preached a resurrection, that they would take an event that would literally change the entire world, and it did. He promised that even though they laid him in a tomb, even though they would scourge and beat him and ultimately crucify him, he promised, on the third day, I will arise. And then that day, I'll be honest with you, I'm glad that I didn't live in biblical times because I'm afraid I would have missed it. I'm glad I get to look back and examine it and investigate a little bit. But can you imagine if you'd been John and you got to the tomb and Mary and Martha just told you, hey, he's gone. Somebody has stolen the body of the Lord. And so John got there, and the Bible says Peter went on in, but they looked into the place where they knew his body had been for 3 days and three nights. And yet when they looked in, they saw, I love this, an empty tomb. You know, for some reason, cemeteries and things of that nature kind of strike fear in our hearts. I remember when I pastored my first church in Mississippi, Pastor Keith, one of the lustrous jobs I had to make money was cut the churchyard because they didn't pay me enough to live on. So they let me preach and cut the yard. And they had a huge cemetery. Matter of fact, there were more people in the cemetery than there were in the community. It was amazing. And so every Saturday I would get there from college, and it was my job to go out and manicure. And boy, in South Mississippi, grass grows. You can watch it grow just about. And so I was out there one Saturday, and I was mowing. I had a push lawnmower, and I backed up to one of the graves, and down there is a lot of sand. And over time, even though it looked like there was a crust, a layer of dirt, it had kind of washed away. And when I stepped into that grave, Pastor Keith, Brother Bobby, I fell into that grave. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. When I came to, I was 5 miles away. Amen. Scared the life out of me. And I got home, and my wife said, and she's so spiritual, I don't know why you're scared. He's dead. I said, well, you go out there and get in it, amen, a little while. Just jump in. It's something about it. It's just unnerving. I don't know. It's scary, but it's unnerving. It's unusual. And yet they looked into what we would call a grave, a tomb. And the Bible said they went in. I just want to say to you today, I could go back and give you historical facts. Josephus, who was the great Jewish historian, gives us many accounts of what had been said about Jesus from the Roman point of view. But I still claim today that the greatest evidence of the resurrection is changed lives. Men and women, boys and girls, who have encountered the resurrected Jesus, the one nothing can conquer Christ. Amen. Romans 8, who can separate us from the love of God? Can death? Can the sword? No. The Bible says because of who he is and because of what he's done, nothing can separate us from the unconquerable, victorious, living Christ. He lives. He lives. You ask me how I know he lives? He lives within my heart. Well, let's look at the story again. So they're there, and they're disturbed, and some of them are depressed. They're just disappointed. And yet Jesus told these sisters, his friends, listen to these words. Jesus said to her in verse 23, your brother will rise again. And she was theologically correct. She said, yeah, sure, I know, Lord. I know that in the resurrection, he will rise again. And so she's probably biblically has a lot of knowledge. She understands life, and she understands death, and she even understands the resurrecting. And she said, yes, Lord, I know that there's coming a future day. And aren't you glad for the hope of eternal life and resurrection? Don't you want to see your loved ones again? Yes. Don't you want to meet the Lord? Yes. Well, that happens in the resurrection. But Jesus changed the subject. Listen, he said, I am. Man, what a claim. You know that there's several here. I am the good shepherd, and I am the bread of life, and I am water. And Jesus, in my opinion, gives the greatest claim of all. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die. And by the way, the Bible says you're going to die. It's pointed unto man once to death. Look at this. He shall live. Could you make that kind of guarantee? Could you make that kind of promise? Man, I can't. I've gone into a lot of hospital rooms. They say, Pastor, please pray that God will heal me. And I said, well, I will pray it, but you understand I can't produce it. Only God, through the person of the Lord Jesus, can produce something like that. And he said, even though you die, yet shall you live. Wow, what a promise, what a claim. What a Christ. Hey, that brings me to the third one here, and I'm not going to stay here very long. It really doesn't have to do with the resurrection. It does, but you'll understand. Notice this, the unstoppable cause. What do you mean by that, Pastor? Well, we live in a world where there's a lot of anti-God, anti-church, anti-Bible, anti-Christianity. This morning I was online, I was listening to a Muslim debate a Christian and how he downplayed Christianity and that Jesus was a fraud and that Jesus did not die, he was not God. And the world seems to be headed that way more and more rather than the other way. The unbelief and the caustic critics who say over and over that the church is just a place where men and women go to believe a fairy tale about somebody who lived and somebody who died. I got news for you. Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Every bit of that is based and built off of the resurrection. Do you understand that? And the reason this cause is unstoppable. Men will die. Women will die. Churches will cease. Ministries will grow. Ministries will cease to exist. But I'm going to tell you what. The ultimate cause, the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Why is that, Pastor? Well, let me give you a couple. Number one, because the truth of the church. You see, this isn't my truth, this isn't your truth, this is his truth. He said, I am the resurrection and the life, and the church triumphant. There's an old song about that, man. And so today, you and I are part of something that the devil is going to fight against us. He's going to do everything he can to keep us, but ultimately, I want you to listen very carefully. This is his kingdom, this is his church. We are his body, and we are his bride. And one day he will complete the work that he started 2,000 years ago on the cross and ultimately at the resurrection. So you and I are part of something that is glorious, that is biblically unstoppable. Listen to what he said. I'm the resurrection. He who believes in me, even if he dies, he shall live. How do you threaten a person who says, you go ahead and kill me, but I'm going to live again? But what do you do to them? I mean, ultimately, death is the greatest threat that we can give to anybody, is it not? Sure. But Jesus said, go ahead, kill us, but it's not going to stop us. Bury us, but we're going to come back to life. Wow. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 Thessalonians 4, phenomenal verses on the unstoppable kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ, all based off of the claim that Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. So you and I live in a world today that may doubt it, may criticize it, may reject it. One day the church will be triumphant. One day you and I will be joined to the head, the body connected, the bride completed. And in that day we will rejoice and celebrate. But I want to get to this last one. And our time is going fast. So listen carefully to your Bible. Not to me, listen to your Bible. So they're in this conversation. And we could go on and read the rest of it where ultimately he talks to Mary and we'll do that. And then he has them to roll away the stone. Do you remember what they said? Lord, don't do that. Man, don't do that. Lord, he's decayed. And I don't mean to be too graphic here, but the idea that, Lord, is he stinks. 4 days, the body is in decomposition. They didn't have the things that we had. And so they said, Lord, please don't do that. It'll be embarrassing. And Jesus asked him to roll the tomb away. I love this. I can't remember. One of my professors in seminary said this. The reason he called Lazarus out was because if he said, come forth, everybody would have got up. Yeah, isn't that a good statement? So he's in this very faith-defining moment with Martha, who really is. And he says this, and whoever lives and believes in me. Now stay with me. So here we have this unbelievable claim. We have this unconquerable Christ. We have this unstoppable cause. But I want you to listen very carefully. Jesus shares an undeniable consequence. Undeniable. Why is it undeniable? Well, here it is in the Bible. And whoever, by the way, same word says, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be what? Saved. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Now listen carefully. Do you believe? So wherever you are, I don't know who all's listening today. A lot of people have been tuning in, and thank you. I hope you will. Go down and hit like and leave some type of comment. I hope you will. But listen, do you believe? Do you believe that he is the unconquerable Christ and that he lived up to that unbelievable claim that he made? Adrian Rogers years ago preached a great message, and I'll be honest with you, I've used it. Simply asked the question, if there had been no resurrection, one of the greater, in my opinion, one of the greater messages that Dr. Rogers, and he preached some of the greatest messages we heard. In that message, he simply said this: if Jesus has not been raised from the dead, 1 Corinthians 15, he's basing off that statement where he said, Paul said, if Jesus be not raised from the dead, we're all people most miserable. Here's what Dr. Rogers said: if Jesus has not been raised from the dead, sin is sovereign. It rules. You can't conquer sin. Here's a good one: your faith is futile. It's silly what you believe in. You're believing in a ghost. You believe in a fairy tale. You believe in something not real, like Santa Claus, like Easter Bunny. And I hope it didn't upset nobody right there, but fairy tale. All right? Your sin would be sovereign. Your faith would be futile. Here's what he said: preaching would be profitless. My whole life, Pastor Keith, would be useless. All the churches you see, all the steeples, all the Bibles, if Jesus was not raised from the dead, everything that we've ever done for 2,000 years in Jesus' name is absolutely worthless. Wow. Worthless. I remember when I was a little boy, I went into a store and I had some change. Back then you could pick up Coke bottles and go sell them. And I know that's absolutely blowing some of young folks' mind, but you could do that, pick up bottles. But I had a couple of bottles and I had a little bit of change. And so I went in to pay and get me a Coke. Back then they were 15 cents. Glory to God. And I remember I gave them two Coke bottles and I gave them some change. And the lady counted my change. She said, hey, this dime is no good. And I said, what do you mean it's no good? She said, it's not American. It's Canadian. I said, what? And I didn't look at it. I just thought it looked like a dime. It was the same size of a dime. But sure enough, I looked on there, and rather than being what should have been there, it was a leaf and whatever their national sign is. And she said, I'm sorry, son, this dime doesn't pass the test. It's not real. It's counterfeit. Counterfeit to us, not to Canadians. So here's what Dr. Rogers' claim was, that if Jesus was not raised from the dead, faith is futile, preaching is profitless, sin is sovereign. Here's one: your future would be fearful. There's nothing to look forward to. I wish I was Dr. Rogers in a way to say some of the things, or E.V. Hill, but because he lives, because he said, I am the resurrection and the life, he came to this conclusion: sin and Satan have been defeated. Faith is not futile. The future is a blessing. And I want you to know today that Jesus is Lord. Listen to this. Do you believe? Wow. He made a big claim. I'm going to be honest. He really did. I'm going to go beyond life into the grave, but I'm going to come back. That's a pretty bold statement. Pretty big claim. And he did it. And because of that, sin and Satan and death and the grave have no hold over his life. So you and I today live as a result of the resurrection. The undeniable consequence is this: that he has changed your life and he's changed my life. That my faith is real. My future is bright. Sin has been defeated. Satan has been overcome. And not even the grave can keep me from God. So he said, I am the resurrection and the life. Do you believe this? Wow. So I don't know what you're going through. Maybe like Mary and Martha, maybe it's a very difficult time at your house. Maybe things look dismal. Maybe as a result of all of this quarantine, you live at home and you just, man, Pastor, it's just miserable. And I want to get out, and I understand all that. Could I be real honest? Maybe the church or some preacher has disappointed you. That happens. We're human. We make mistakes. And so maybe you live in disillusionment to the church because there was somebody that you looked up to and you thought, when I need them, they'll be there. When I need something, they'll provide it. And yet they, in your mind, in your estimation, they didn't come through. Jesus, where are you at? Where have you been? We've been waiting for you. If you'd only been here. Wow. A lot of disappointment. A lot of discouragement. Maybe that's where you are today. But I tell you, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Wow, what a great song. I love Rise Again. I love Arise, My Love. But because he lives, I don't presume to know what you're going through, but I do know this. because he lives, you and I can live also. So wherever you are, whatever you're going through, whatever moment you're living in, today we celebrate the resurrection. The fact that Jesus bodily died. And by the way, let me make that clear. He didn't die just swoon on the cross. He died physically and he was raised bodily. He died on the cross ultimately as much as a man could die, and he was raised. So today, as we face life with all the difficulties, with all the disappointments, with all the things that we might throw and hurl and say at things of this life, I just want to say today, because he lives, we can face tomorrow. So wherever you are right now, would you just bow your head? Would you just close your eyes? Would you just say, Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, I went to church when I was little, but something happened. Maybe a church fight, maybe a church split, maybe a preacher failed, maybe a deacon did something that disillusioned you. And as a result of that, it's tainted, it's colored your view of the church. Could I ask you to do something? Get your eyes off men and get your eyes on him. Men will always disappoint you, but he never will. Mary thought, Martha thought that he showed up late, but he was right on time. Matter of fact, if you read scripture, he said, I'm glad that I didn't come earlier. I'm glad because this death is for the glory of God. So whatever you're going through, he knows. He knows where you are and what's going on. Now listen to me carefully. Lazarus died. They wept. They cried. Their hearts were broken. They couldn't believe that Jesus didn't come and heal their friend. Some things happen in life that are very hard and difficult. But I want you to know, he said, if you believe in me, even though you die, yet shall you live. Wow. What a claim. Would you trust him today? And then I believe he looked in Martha's eyes and said, Martha, do you believe me? And she said, yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Christ that was to come into the world. So today, would you say, Lord, help my unbelief. God, help my weaknesses. Father, help me this day to remember and to rejoice and to celebrate the greatest event in human history. It wasn't the discovery of some great medicine. It wasn't the cure of some horrible disease. It wasn't finding an atom or entering into the industrial age that we live in today with atomic and now even nuclear energy. All those have their places. They're good, but nothing compares to what happened on the cross. And then subsequently, 3 days later, an empty tomb. Nothing compares to that. Do you believe? Will you believe? Now, Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for grace and mercy. Thank you for coming to us, Lord, at the right time and doing what needs to be done. Forgive us when we're weak. Forgive us when we have unbelief. And Lord, would you today help us to trust in you. So today we serve a risen Savior. He is in the world today, and I know that he's living no matter what men may say. So on this Easter, as unusual as it is, remember, because he lives. We can
now with our family takeout special.
Tomorrow.
Get a free foot.
Amen.
You buy two.
I guess I'm through. God bless you guys. Amen. That's the way to end the sermon. Amen. That's funny, Brother Dave. That was, I don't know. I don't know what we did, but what? That's funny.
Go ahead.